Welcome to the Superdome in New Orleans for the 1993 Sugar Bowl between the Alabama Crimson Tide and the Miami Hurricanes. Let's start the game here on ESPN Classic.
We're just about ready for the ball game. Gene Stallings walking the sidelines. Big, big chance for him to make a major point at home. Dennis Erickson has already made his point at home. The two coaches have been remarkable in their current jobs. The Miami Hurricanes, defending national champions, will have the ball first. Alabama won the first contest of the evening. They won the toss, and they deferred to the second half. The officials for the ball game, Southwest Conference, Rogers Redding, the referee. Playing inside, obviously, they're on a rug. The deep people for Miami will be number 5, Kevin Williams, number 3, Jonathan Harris. And it has long been my feeling that the little men would have something to say about the outcome of this ball game. Michael Proctor getting ready to kick it off, and here is perhaps the most dangerous man on the entire roster for the Miami Hurricanes, Kevin Williams. He is a junior from Dallas, Texas. So let us play for the national championship. They kick it right to Williams at the 1. They pin him up short of the 20. George Teague, the first man to get there for Alabama. Number 13 right there. Gino Toretta, another number 13. Bit of a daring fellow there, coming out with 13 on himself. As a quarterback, he is 26-1. He has led this team to a national championship. He has won the Heisman Trophy. He is the most decorated player in Miami University football history. They will open with Donnell Bennett as the running back, and they will start from their own 18-yard line, first down. Double wide to the top of the picture. Miami will spread you all over the field. Toretta turns, throws to Bennett. Two men in front of him, and he's taken down just over the 20-yard line. Sam Shade came up and got his man. Kevin Williams will be at a slot position, at a wide position occasionally. In fact, he will be a tailback on occasions. Donnell Bennett, as you saw, the lone back there. Horace Copeland and Lamar Thomas, with Coleman Bell the tight end, and it's Thomas who's perhaps the most dangerous of that group. It is the offensive line, however, that has been a big problem and story for Miami this season. Toretta working out of the shotgun. Alabama shows blitz. They don't go. They do get pressure with Curry in pursuit. Now they go get him. Run him down at the original line of scrimmage, the 18. It's Tommy Johnson who got there. The offensive front for Miami, we were talking about, they will start tonight with 5 seniors up there. A lot of veterans. They're all fifth-year seniors after having had to play some freshmen and having to move Etheridge from a tight end to a tackle. Cristobal coming off injury. So the offensive line is in better shape tonight than it has been all season for Miami. It is 3rd down and 10 now for the Canes back at the 18. Alabama, they have 7, 8 people up on the line. Out of the shotgun, they go after him. Got the heat on him, his pass is away, and the pass is dropped by Coleman Bell, incomplete. And so, Alabama could come out of this with pretty good field position as Miami will go to the punt, and Alabama will send David Palmer, number 2, deep, and he, like Kevin Williams, is a dynamite kick returner who can give you very good field position if he should miss the end zone. Paul Snyder, a senior from Laguna Niguel, California, is the punter. He's standing inside his 5. He'll hit it around the 8. Palmer waits at the 42. Low kick. Palmer's got room. 3 Canes coming after him. Runs between 2 of them. He's got a hole! He's all the way back down to the 24-yard line. That's field position. Donnell Bennett brought him down. The deuce. has put Alabama's offense on the front porch.
As advertised, David Palmer, he's run four punts back in his career for touchdowns. He's only played 2 years at Alabama. He had three punt returns last year and won the first game of this year that he played.
If he takes it to the right side or to his right, he might have scored. 24-yard line, first down for Alabama. Barker turns, pitches to Lassick. He goes right up the middle and gets it down to the 20-yard line where Greer brings him down. Jay Barker is a young man, a sophomore from Trussville, Alabama. 6'5", 209. He's 16-0 as a starter. Kind of interesting that the place kicker for the Hurricanes of Miami, Pruitt, comes from Trussville, Alabama.
Good friends with Jay Barker, the quarterback for Alabama.
Second down and five. Big play here for Lassick. He's inside the 10. It's first and goal to go for the Tide. Jesse Armstead brought him down.
Watch the right tackle. That's going to be 77, Patterson. It's a little trap play. Alabama doesn't run a lot of traps, but they saw in the Syracuse game against Miami late in the year that some trap plays were successful. They put some traps in and some misdirection to go against that fast and quick Miami defense.
Derek Lassick is from Haverstraw, New York. He's 190 pounds. We saw him have a very big day against Tennessee. The referee, Rogers Redding, has called timeout and points toward Miami. The story on the Alabama offense, as they have operated inside the 20-yard line this season, they have been quite efficient. Thank you.
Miami defensively, 23 times opponents have been in there. They've scored 16 of those 23.
Ball is just inside the 6-yard line. It's first down and goal for the Red Elephants. And Barker rolls it to the right, flips it. Had the ball tipped at the line of scrimmage. One of the Canes got his hand on it. I think it was Casey Greer, number 29. He had his man wide open. And just a little finger stopped it.
He's rolling out. Barrel runs through the opening, but there was nobody there. He was trying to hit the halfback.
Classic. He was wide open. So Casey Greer makes a big play for the Hurricanes. And it's second down and goal for Alabama at the 6. 12 minutes and 22 seconds to play in the first quarter. Go to Lassick. Power football to the left side and down to the 3. Running into the boundary, hoping that the offensive blocking could outnumber the defense. And they get 3 yards on the play. Michael Barrow and Kevin Patrick on the tackle for the Canes.
The Hurricanes have given up 14 touchdowns this year, and only 4 of those 14 were on the ground. The other 10 in the air.
Third and goal outside the 3. Miami defense being tested early. Set up by David Palmer's punt return. That was set up by Alabama's staunch defensive play in the first series. Barker rolls it right, cuts it back into the middle, dives for the goal line, and he can't get there. Robert Bass, number 49, a middle linebacker who had been added to the goal line defense, turned him back, and the kicking team is in.
Miami defensively coming into the game. Scoring defense in the nation is third best. They only allow 12 points on an average. There was a hole there for a second. Barker couldn't get there quick enough, and the speed of Miami closed it up.
All right, he's taken it down at the 2-yard line, and here is Michael Proctor. It's a 19-yard field goal try. It's good. But in a way, you got to think that Miami feels like they won something too. Alabama got the 3 to lead it by a field goal. Well, both teams may have learned a little something as first and goal at the 6. The Tide is turned away by a tough Miami defense. And now the kickoff will go probably right to him again. First time we opened the ball game, they kicked it right to Kevin Williams. They got him short of the 20. Let's see what they decide to do this time.
Alabama score, Keith, really set up, first of all, by the good defense, three and out for Miami, but then, of course, the punt return by David Palmer.
Mocker hits a good one. Inside the end zone, a yard deep, Williams is coming. Goes to the boundary, looking for a hole, not there. Lost the ball as he was hit on the boundary, but the ball went out of bounds, and again, it is Teague coming down the field up belting. So as Geno comes out for the Miami offense, here's a look at your Alabama defense.
And because Miami uses three wide receivers and only one back, Alabama will play with four defensive linemen right there, two linebackers, Lemanski, Hall, and Oden, and five defensive backs. Langham and Teague are the primary corners with all the interceptions.
You have Stephen McGuire, number 30, in the backfield now for the first time. He's been injured much of the season, but he's healthy. He's a good one. They give it to him. He slides along the line of scrimmage. He'll pick up a yard. Seven of the 11 All-SEC defensive players in 1992 came from Alabama. Curry, Copeland, Hall, London, Langham, Odom, and Teague.
And four of those players are All-Americans. As you take a look at how stingy the Crimson Tide have been in the first quarter.
Second down and nine for Miami. Things beginning to settle just a little bit. In a game of this stature, the first 5 minutes, the adrenaline is pounding. Now it seems to be settling a bit. Toretta out of the shotgun, buying a little time, getting the heat now, throws, pass complete, passes complete up to the 26-yard line to Horace Copeland. And Copeland is taken down rather firmly at the 26. Now let's say a happy new year to our partner, Jack Arute.
Happy new year to everybody, too. Keith, you talked about this 50,000-plus Bama fans. Well, it certainly is a noisy partisan crowd. But let me tell you what Rogers Redding, the referee for tonight's contest, told both teams in pregame meetings. He said he does not prefer to invoke the noise rule. He says, gentlemen, you will have to play through the noise. That could come into play tonight.
Third down and about four. Toretta lifting the leg, indicating to the center everything's all right. That little pop pass over the middle to Kevin Williams, and he's on his way across midfield. He's all the way down to the Alabama 39-yard line. They may put it on the 40, but there's the blazing speed of Kevin Williams coming to the fore.
They've been doubling the outside receivers out here. Here's Williams. He's not going to go downfield. He's going to come underneath the coverage, and he's going to hit the wide receiver on a little slant route, and he runs away from everybody else. If he goes downfield, they're going to double cover him, so he comes across field and makes a big play on the run.
Number 10, Tommy Johnson, the man that ran him down. Ball is just an inch or so inside the 40-yard line. Toretta goes back under center to a one-back offense set. Stands up quickly, lets it go down the middle, and the pass was incomplete, intended for Darryl Spencer, number 35. He is another fellow who is listed as a tailback, but in fact plays in a wide position more than he does the running back position. Alabama is leading in the ball game on a 19-yard field goal, 3-0. Toretta is now 3 for 5, 42 yards, and has been taken down one time. There, his career, very impressive numbers.
The thing about Toretta, too, Keith, he doesn't turn it over. Over 400 passes this year, only 7 interceptions.
Donnell Bennett back in the lineup, big fella, 227. Now he steps up into a slot, so it's a no-back set. And Toretta drops back and throws, and he hits his man right on the numbers. Jonathan Harris, number 3. 5'9", 165-pound sophomore out of Houston, Texas. He turned and angled for the marker, and he went just past it. First down, Miami. Quite a story about the fellow who wears that Ibis suit.
That's right. John Ruth, the Miami Ibis, was down Bourbon Street and was struck by a bullet they think was fired in celebration from a far away. It came straight down and just grazed him. Raised his cheek. He's all right in uniform tonight.
First down, put it on the 29 of Alabama. Miami is beginning to mount its first threat, but nothing there this time as Stephen McGuire, the senior out of Brooklyn, New York, is put on his back for a loss of a couple of yards. We'll show you the scores of other games. The Southeastern Conference, incidentally, is doing very well in the postseason. They're undefeated so far. And there is one more game to be played tomorrow, Mississippi State playing in the Peach Bowl. Stanford had a big win for them today. And you see Georgia, Ohio State, that would be a good ball game down in the Citrus Bowl. Ball comes back to the 32, where it is second down and 13 for Miami. And Toretta drops back again to the shotgun. It's a short shotgun. Puts it high in the air. And the Miami receiver going down the sidelines, Kevin Williams, had no chance to get to it. Right here, let us take 5 seconds so our ABC stations across the country can tell you who they are. Three to nothing, Alabama leading. Miami got a little threat going here on third down and 13. The ball resting at the Alabama 32-yard line. Dean Stallings there. You just saw Dennis Erickson, the coaches.
I was just going to say Alabama doing a nice job defensively of mixing up their coverages, giving Gino Toretta a lot of different looks.
John Copeland is in a down position right now and playing over a guard. There's a long pass to the sidelines intended for Lamar Thomas. He looked inside, then looked outside, and by that time he had no chance, and there was pretty good coverage again. In fact, there were two Alabama people over there. The Michigan Wolverines get a win, 38-31 over the Washington Huskies. And so Gary Moeller can probably go home to a little peace now.
Well, they haven't won too many Rose Bowls in the last few trips out there.
All right, this will be a 39-yard field goal try for Dane Pruitt. 49-yard field goal try. Got a lot of leg on it. And made it. So Pruitt hits from 49 yards. And we're all even at 3 with 7:49 to go in the first quarter.
With Alabama and Miami all tied at 3, Mike Proctor pulled the Tide ahead of the Canes with a 23-yard field goal early in the second quarter. We pick up the action now with 9:20 remaining in the first half of the 1993 Sugar Bowl.
Well, Gino Toretta, the fifth-year senior, has had his troubles with this Alabama defense.
He's had two problems, Keith. He's number one, it's been the Alabama defense confusing him, and he's had to take some timeouts when he tried to check off. And the other thing has been the noise. What you can do on that is you just have to have some plays that are good against anything that the defense is going to throw up there and just go with it.
It is second down and 4 with Bennett, the single back. Fumble by Toretta coming away on the snap, covers the ball. Gino falls on it back at the 45. And you get a little bit of a ruckus there. And Curry gets tangled up with Coleman Bell and number 72, Mario Cristobal. And Rogers Redding is in the middle of it. Now, Cristobal is 280 pounds. Curry is 265. And both of them chew bark for breakfast.
and the referee's about 190. He just pulled out a little bit, looking the other direction. You expect that ball to be there. It's like a no-brainer, and that cost him a down there.
It's third and 9 after the fumble. They go to the shotgun. Pretty good protection. Down the middle, intercepted. Picked off by Sam Shade. Sam's inside the 35, down to the 31.
Take a look at what they're doing. They're doubling the two outside receivers over here. The man he tries to get the ball to is the tight end down the middle. Now watch as the man covering the tight end, that's Shade. If you stop it right there, stop it. There he is, right there, and he intercepts the ball. Good coverage, doubling the outside and running with the inside man.
And the Tide is operating at the Miami 31 with Derek Lassick, the single back. He's got the ball. And he pounds his way down to the 28-yard line. The Alabama defense, since Gene Stallings took over in Tuscaloosa, has 61 pass interceptions and 37 ball games. Well, he brought some kind of a message and plan with him, didn't he? I think probably named Bill Oliver, don't you reckon?
Well, Oliver was a key, and they were fourth in the nation in turnover margin. They had a plus 18 coming into the ball game. They'd taken it away 18 more times and they'd given it away.
Lassick again. Big hole. They're back down knocking on the door again at the 3-yard line, first and goal. Jesse Armstead and Casey Greer finally got him down. And Derek Lassick has 15 carries, and with 7 minutes and 35 seconds to go in the first half, has 105 yards.
Just a little toss. Linebacker right there, Barrow's going to overrun it. Now big 77, Patterson in red right there downfield, trying to help out. That's a double, what's the fullback again. That's Houston, number 35. The middle linebacker, Barrow, misses it.
So it's first and goal. Give it to Lassick for the one. Roosevelt Patterson at 6'4", 295. And he was right down there at his running back's elbow trying to lend a hand.
I tell you what, though, Lassick can thank his fullback and his tight end, Buskey, 83, and the fullback, Houston, because those two guys, even though they are eligible receivers, are really offensive lineman types, and they really can block.
Second down and goal from the one. Lassick, nothing at the top. Tried to go over the top, and that's a pretty hard thing to do.
Miami, as I mentioned, tough to score on. Third in the nation scoring defense. They just toughen up. That's a good play. That's Bass, 49, the backup inside linebacker.
But they're all in there. Paul White, who's a corner, he was down under the bottom of it at stack. They're all up there involved. Third down and goal from the two, and Sherman Williams checks in. Williams in the middle, touchdown. Michael Proctor will try the point out of Jeff Wall's hold. Matthew Pine will snap it. The interception by Sam Shade led to this touchdown for Alabama. Kick is good. 6:09 to play in the first half. It is now Alabama 13, Miami 3. Another look at the touchdown by Williams. A little move to the left. He takes it back into the middle, and plenty of daylight.
As time expired in the second quarter, Dane Pruitt of Miami cut the Alabama lead to 7 with a 42-yard field goal. We go now to the start of the second half with Bama leading Miami 13-6 in the 1993 Sugar Bowl right here on ESPN Classic.
Teams are back in the stadium, not far from the second half of play. 13-6, Alabama leads. Here's Jackaroo.
Well, Keith, when we kicked off our college football season, we were in Iowa for the first Miami-Iowa game, but we were all concentrating and chronicling the problems in South Florida as the devastation of Hurricane Andrew took its toll. We looked at it through the eyes of Michael Barrow's mother, May Barrow, in Homestead, Florida. Her house totally devastated. Well, as the Red Cross closed their last and final aid station earlier this week, I'm pleased to tell you as well that May Barrow returned to her home in Homestead, Florida on Christmas Day, and she is watching her son and the rest of the Miami Hurricanes play from her home once again.
Great story.
Isn't that a great story?
Pretty fine young man right there, too. Michael's probably be glad to get his bed back instead of sleeping on the couch.
He's got other business to take care of right now. As first half statistics, total plays about the same, but Miami rushing only 6 yards, passing 127, and for Alabama, their rushing is 152 and only 12 yards passing. Total yardage is in favor of Alabama. Turnovers are the same. Two interceptions for Barker in the first quarter. He hasn't had to throw any more after that. I'm sure they'll downplay that some in the second half. And for Toretta, it was a tough first half. He had an interception. And I'm sure that Dennis Erickson and Toretta and Rich Olson, the offensive quarterback coach, tried to get straightened out. What the Alabama defense is doing, both in the defensive front and in the secondary.
But the point is, only a touchdown and a conversion. 7 points separate the team. That's one throw. So, at 10, you figure when you're playing a football team, when you get them down 10 points and you learn that is the biggest deficit they've had the entire season, you know you're playing some pretty tough guys. And there is Geno. Sorting things out, and Alabama will have the ball first because they had won the toss and deferred, and so Miami will be kicking to them to start the second half of play. Here are the numbers off the first half.
Look on the left side where it says Miami 24, Alabama got a field goal. It says Miami 31, Alabama got a touchdown. That's field position inside Miami's 31-yard line. They got two scores that way. Barker is 2 of 8, only 12 yards and two interceptions. Lassick with 106 yards. And really, Palmer and Wembley, nothing there. Proctor, 2 of 2 with field goals. Greer for Miami, the strong safety, has 8 tackles. That's not good when your strong safety is leading you in tackles. And one interception.
And David Palmer waits now for Dane Pruitt's kickoff to start the second half of play. First time he had it, he went back 17. This one goes to Williams. Sherman Williams, he can run too. Out to the 20 he comes. And taken down there. And Bass, number 49, among those involved in the tackle. And the Crimson Tide will go to work from the 20. This has been a tough ticket for a good long time when it became apparent that it would be this matchup of number one Miami and number two Alabama. We open with Lassick and Houston in the backfield behind Jay Barker. Wembley is number 32 and he's the wide man. They put Lassick in motion and throw on the first play. Set up a screen for Wembley on a wide receiver screen that works for about 5 yards. Jesse Armstead, number one linebacker, was over very quickly on the play.
That's a safe pass, Keith. That is one of the two passes that he completed in the first half. We talked about the two defensive ends a little bit, about Patrick, number 86 for Miami, and Krein, number 91 on the other side. They really haven't done much. Patrick putting a little pressure. Of course, there's not much to do when a team doesn't throw a lot of passes and you're a defensive end and rush the passer line.
Kevin Lee goes in motion for Alabama. Run it with Lassick off the right side on second down and 5. And Michael Barrow is there for a tackle. Another one. He picks up a couple of yards and he'll be looking at third down and about 3.
The defense of Miami, Keith, has to
dominate this game, take charge of it. They have not controlled the line of scrimmage like they would have liked to. There's Shields, 61 on Barrow. Barrow seems to have held his ground and won out, but this defense, not the offense, has been the strength of Miami the last couple of years.
Now David Palmer goes in motion.
Blitz.
Barker lets it go for Palmer, and he's held up on the sideline. Crowd over there hooting for a call, but good defensive play by White. He just blocked him into the boundary, and Palmer could not get down that sideline.
It's an out and up, and you can jam them like that as long as they're in front of you and the ball has not been thrown.
When the ball was thrown, it was too late. Kevin Williams is back waiting for the punt. Brian Deal's first kick with the roll on the rug was 57 yards. No pressure on him, and he gets it out, and it's a good kick. High spinning spiral for Kevin Williams to the 29. They run him into the sidelines and run him out of bounds. So it's going to be good field position for the Canes. 43-yard punt, 9-yard return. This is what happened in the Canes in the first half.
Miami got the ball in the third possession in Alabama's 39 and didn't do anything with it. They got a field goal just before half, which should have done some good things for them going in at halftime. Toretta, 12 of 25 and 127 yards. Pruitt, 2 of 2 in field goals, has really kept them in the ball game.
Number 88, Horace Copeland, has come back into the starting offensive lineup. So he's shaken off the ding that he took in the first half, and he's back out there. Donnell Bennett is the single back behind Toretta. Lamar Thomas is wide to the bottom of the picture. Toretta lets it go, and it's intercepted by Tommy Johnson. And Johnson is all the way down to the 20-yard line. Tommy Johnson having a huge ball game tonight.
Well, you mentioned a huge ball game, Keith. He led the team in tackles in the first half, as you see Erickson. He's going to throw it to the left side, a little quick out. Three steps and out. Johnson is the nickelback. He is the fifth back that's been playing the entire ball game. That's his interception, first interception. He's had a sack, he's broken up two passes, and he's caused a fumble earlier in the ball game. He has been active.
Ball is just inside the 21 with the Alabama posing a threat here. Give it a Lassick, picks his way to the 20. And that'll be it. As Darren Krein, first time tonight, I've called his name. The big junior out of Aurora, Colorado. Defensive end.
Here's Johnson here on the interception, and the man's going to go down and break to the outside. He's just going to cut in front of him. That's Williams, number 5, in the slot. Breaks to the outside. That's just a great read by Johnson and a poor throw. You see him looking at you like that. You can't throw it out there.
Alabama has called a timeout. 13-6 tied leading, and the Tide knocking on the door to start the second half. Not a good night so far for the Heisman Trophy winner, Geno Toretta, quarterback, Miami Hurricane. The Alabama folks over there really giving it to him right now. It is second down and about 10, closer to 9, if you will, from the 20-yard line. Barker pitches it. Lassick gives it. Kept it. Turns it into the middle. Runs away from tacklers. Great run by Lassick. Gets it down to about the 13-yard line. He's going to be 2 or 3 yards short of his first down. He faked it to Palmer. Picked his way through the traffic. Good run.
This has been the Derek Lassick show offensively. We haven't had a lot of offense. The two field goal kickers have both made 2 field goals, but Derek Lassick rushing for over 100 yards in the first half has been the offense.
A touchdown man has just come in, Curtis Brown. Remember him?
Yep. Had the touchdown in the SEC championship game.
Right. He's wide top of the picture. Got Ryan McNeil on him over there. But Palmer goes that way to help him. Opening it up, and Palmer's wide open, and it can't get the ball to him. Barker runs for the first down. They mark him out at about the 4. It'll be first down and goal, Alabama.
There's a look at Palmer in motion. Now he's going to go and break to the left to the back of the end zone. Now McNeil is out there, number 47. He kind of comes back and picks him up. If the ball would have been thrown, he may have picked it off. It had to have been a very sharp, hard throw to get it in there.
Yeah, but that was late. It could have been gone a good 2 seconds sooner.
Yeah, but not from a
kind of a double team on McNeil. They sent Brown over there, and we've got a face mask call.
We have a face mask foul against the defense.
It's kind of like a replay of the last time, isn't it?
First down.
There's a look at Smith, 45, the linebacker.
The ball is at the 2-yard line.
Here's a look at Miami coming in. They had given the ball away 15 times this year, and it had led to only 2 opponent TDs. That's pretty strong.
Vlasic will not get anywhere near that goal line. He is rolled up in a hurry with McNeil coming out of that corner position to lead the tacklers. He's a tough kid, isn't he?
He really is. Keith, he's an All-American, as you mentioned. He runs the 40 and 4-4. He'll be high on the list when draft time comes up in the NFL this spring.
Alabama trying to reverse that stat from the regular season. They lead in the ball game at the USF&G Sugar Bowl by a score of 13-6. Vlasic is out of there now, and Sherman Williams, who has scored Alabama's touchdown, is in. He's a speedster. Here goes Parker. Pursuit coming from the back. He can't get there. He's run down by Dexter Siegler. Siegler came around the corner and just simply outran Jay Parker to make the tackle short of the goal
line. Number 34 is coming from the entire backside. You talk about the speed of Miami. Look at this cornerback just runs him down from behind.
It is third down and goal from the 1, and Vlasic comes back. Well, I tell you, that's like trying to climb a cactus to score against this Miami
Keith,
crowd, isn't it?
I wouldn't be surprised to see a run to the left, because if they throw it, it'd be very tough to kick a field goal from that right hash.
Vlasic. Touchdown.
Well, you don't need to kick field goals when you can get it into the end zone.
Big Uglies on the right side gave him a crack.
At Stevenson and Patterson, Buskey the tight end. Siegler 34 runs around the block. Good running by Vlasic, and really some shoddy tackling by the Hurricanes.
Johnny Howard snaps it. Buckley's kick is up. And good. Alabama has scored 14 points off Miami turnovers and lead 20-6. Derek Vlasic, who put it in the end zone for the tied second touchdown, has 22 carries, 116 yards. In case you wonder, the Sugar Bowl rushing record, Tony Dorsett, 202 yards when Pittsburgh played Georgia here.
All the coaches, you ever ask them what's the key to this game, they'll always tell you turnovers, turning the ball over.
A 20-6 lead as Alabama kicks off to Miami with Harris and Williams waiting. This will be Williams at the 7. Devitt searching around, finds enough daylight to get the ball out to about the 29-yard line. He's a tough little guy. Here are the scores of games earlier in the day. Tennessee was impressive. So was Notre Dame. And Stanford. And Georgia. Syracuse beat Colorado. Michigan finally won a Rose Bowl after being frustrated for so long. And Florida State is leading Nebraska in the fourth quarter by 20. Curry is back in the lineup. He missed that last series for Alabama. They worked on him some. He's fixed up. He's back. Miami now going to work out of the shotgun from the 29. They're down by 14. And Peretta intercepted by Teague. George Teague to the end zone. Touchdown.
Defense wins championships, and Alabama's got the best defense in the country.
Well, they are so well prepared, and Dennis Erickson made that point last night when I was talking to him. He said they have had a lot more time to get ready for us than they had to get ready for Florida. Even though we learned something by looking at the Florida tape, we still know that they've had a lot of time to prepare, and it shows. Buckner's point is good. With 9:56 to play in the third quarter, it is now Alabama 27 and Miami 6.
Take a look now. Every one of the red shirts are up there. They're going to blitz, they're going to fake blitz. Here's Teague right here. Now the route is going to be, when you see blitz, they break it off right in here. Watch as Teague reads the route and breaks inside of Harris, the expected wide receiver. They drop back. They don't blitz. It was a fake. Now he knows the route better than the receiver. He jammed him. He got in there. That's good film study and good preparation by the University of Alabama. Teague knew what he was doing. This is his first touchdown interception of the year.
Time remaining in the third quarter, 27-6 now. Alabama leads Miami. Geno Toretta, two passes in this half, two interceptions, and one Alabama touchdown. Four turnovers leading to a total of 21 Alabama points. And that last play by Teague covered 31 yards on the touchdown return.
It's nothing new for Gene Stallings' group. They're fourth in the nation, as I mentioned earlier, in the turnover margin. They're now up to plus 21.
Buckner will kick it off. Harrison Williams waits. Williams at the two. Good block trying to get into the sideline, but red shirts this morning.
Watch the interception again now from the left side of your screen. Number three. This is an interception for Toretta, but it's really the fault of the receiver because he didn't get in there where he was supposed to be. The quarterback is expecting the receiver to be in there on a little slant if they're blitzing, and he didn't get in there. The defensive back, Teague, knew where he was going.
Yeah, but these receivers are not used to being treated like this either.
And
just getting boxed around.
Harris is small, and Teague is big and jammed him at the line. Didn't get off the line of scrimmage.
12-yard line, and it's Miami's worst starting position of the night for a possession. Hand the ball to Donnell Bennett, and they eat him up. I don't think he got back to the line of scrimmage.
If you're a Hurricane now, especially if you got number 13 and your name is Toretta, your confidence has got to be a little bit down. You've thrown three interceptions, and things have not gone well. You're playing the top defense in the country, and this is a long uphill climb. You see Cristobal, the right tackle, is back in the ballgame.
It'll be second down and about 11. He did lose on that last play. Lemanski Hall is now right in the middle. That says blitz. Passes away. Penalty flag down. Lamar Thomas has got it. Lamar Thomas is on his way down the sideline. George Teague is after him and runs him down.
Takes the ball.
Takes the ball away from him. Teague's got the ball. And they tackle Teague back up to 12. But you got a penalty flag all the way back up here at the 11-yard line at the other end of the field. Rogers Redding is talking with the official who threw it. They're walking down the field, and here's the call. Offside, and the offside is against Alabama. The offside is against Alabama. And so all of this flurry of excitement.
George Teague is unbelievable. He can chase Lamar Thomas down from that far away. Teague is the man that just intercepted and ran the one in for a touchdown.
Plays the ball's coming back. Here's Rogers ready.
They'll take the play. They'll take the penalty.
We have offside on the defense. 5-yard penalty. Replay second down.
So Miami takes the play.
Sure. Of course they take the penalty.
But instead of Erickson having a completion way down, maybe a touchdown. This is a great throw here. Single coverage outside. Look at this throw. And look at Teague. Thomas is supposed to have some speed. And a great play by Teague, knowing he's behind him, knocked the ball out of his hands, and he takes it away from him.
But Miami accepts the penalty. Offsides against Alabama. They keep the football, and this in remarkable play by George Teague is firmly recorded for him to watch when he's 40.
If they would have accepted the, not accepted the, they take the penalty because they don't want the play. The play obviously gives the ball over to Alabama.
So put the football at the 16-yard line. Gene Stallings is man and hornet again. At it, second down and 5. Both teams kind of wobbling around here as Doretta sets them up. Tide shows blitz. They go cruising in looking for Toretta, and Toretta trying to pop out of the middle. Well, maybe they were trying to run a quarterback draw.
Let's go back to the previous play. See if there's an offsides, unless it's the man close down here at the bottom with his hand.
Somebody's in the zone. Yeah, there he is right there.
He may be lined up offsides, yep. Yeah. It's hard to see anybody offsides.
It's 55. That's London. Antonio London, yeah. He got started a little soon, got in the neutral zone.
What a big downer for Miami, though. You finally hit a play, your fastest receiver, one of your fastest. You think you got a touchdown, and you end up back inside your own 20 again.
And on top of that, just for show, he had the ball taken away from him. Toretta lets it go, intended for Copeland, and Toretta is just buried under the red shirt as he let the pass go, and he misses. It's fourth down.
Here's a look at Alabama defensively. They've taken it away 4 times. They've got 21 points off the turnovers. Miami's only 3 of 8 on third down conversions, and 5 times Miami has had the ball 3 plays or less and out.
David Palmer now comes back, wait for the punt, and he's going to be standing somewhere around his 45-yard line waiting for the kick. It'll be the 4th point punt of the night by Paul Schneider. Should be pretty good field position. Palmer will take it. Take off with it. And bring it back to about midfield. And so with 8:01 to go in the third quarter, the Tide leading by 21, they're sitting right in the middle of the field. That simply says the fourth quarter belongs to us. You see a lot of football teams doing it, but that's Alabama, their side of the house. Miami, we've seen them do it a couple of times, but if they win this fourth quarter, they better come out with their motor running. But they're down by 21, 27-6. And they start at the 24-yard line. First down. Toretta gets it off, and the pass, again, there was double coverage. The pass intended for Horace Copeland. Antonio London and Antonio Langham were both there. They had him between them. Very difficult, if not impossible, to complete.
Defensive backs have just flat covered the Miami receivers.
Yep, they've whipped them.
Here's Miami in number one versus number two. The one loss is number one, and they've won the 3 times they have won, they have been ranked number two. So they're looking at losing another one when they're ranked number one.
The history here in the Sugar Bowl has been for number two to win. It happened to Geno's falling down, but throws the ball as he is falling down, and they're going to let him have it. He tripped as he pulled away from the snap. And Florida State has defeated Nebraska 27-14. That score is final in the Orange Bowl. After this game, there'll be only one of the bowl games left. That'll be the Peach Bowl in Atlanta.
Right guard Kip Vickers, number 78, stepped on Toretta's right foot.
Well, that happens a lot.
It does. It really does.
Is that why you walk funny?
Well, no. And the reason it happens is not because the quarterback is slow getting away. It is that the guard or the center move before they normally do, or take a much larger step, or move too quickly.
Curry puts the heat on. He delivers the ball to Kevin Williams, and they take Williams down right about the 25-yard line. Derek Oden, 56, the key man on the hit. He's another tough guy.
This Alabama defense, the starters have only allowed 8 touchdowns all year long, and they have scored 4 touchdowns, the defense has, for Alabama. 12 games, they've allowed 8 touchdowns, and they've scored 4. So net, they've given up four touches.
Kick is out of there by Snyder. Palmer got it at the 37, tried to pop between two and can't do it, and goes down at the 40. You know, as we look at the third quarter numbers here and the domination by Alabama, that people are going to start asking the question, Bob, is this one of the great defensive teams of all time?
Well, it certainly is one of the best that I've seen in a long time, but you're better judging of that than I am. You've been around this for 40 years.
Yeah, but you go back to the times when they played the one platoon.
Yeah.
There were some great defensive teams back
it's
then.
It's tough to compare teams
compare.
In different eras. The
no.
rules change.
Yep. Can't do it. That's a Lynch carrying the ball there, and he picks up about 4 yards. A moment now with Jackaroo.
Well, Keith, you know, in order for Alabama to make it to the Sugar Bowl, they had to defeat their SEC rivals and also the ones that won the Eastern Division in this first ever championship game in Birmingham. Who was that? The Florida Gators. Well, listen to what happened. Shane Matthews called the team in the locker room earlier, wished them well. There were 35 players from Florida watching the game at Florida Field on a big screen TV.
Yep, there's some contact.
Florida certainly did a lot better offensively against this Alabama defense than Miami is doing here tonight.
Looked like Mark Caesar just won't knock somebody down.
Walked
him one.
Frustrating.
We have a dead ball foul. False start.
False start. Caesar within his rights to do what he did. And Thebes is really hot. He knows these guys, these officials, too, because he was in the Southwest for so long. That's what happened in the postseason with these Southeastern Conference teams. Now, I walked around for much of this year thinking that the Pac-10 might have been the toughest league in the country. But right now, you there's no argument.
This is a great barometer, a great judge.
It is.
The strength of the conferences.
Second down and 12. And this is Tarrant Lynch. Enough teams get a hold of it and tumble him back. There is one game left to play, as we said a little while ago, in the Peach Bowl, as Mississippi State Jackie Sherrill Ball Club plays North Carolina over in Atlanta.
The series goes back a ways. A lot of those victories were in the 70s when Alabama was dominating. I think they only played one time. They didn't play at all in the 80s. They played the one game in
1990. Barker throws incomplete, intended for Curtis Brown, and defended by Paul White. White at 5'9", giving away about 4 or 5 inches on that play, but he made it. And so the Tide will have to give the ball away again on the punt. As we are in the fourth quarter of play, it was the third quarter where the sky really fell on the Hurricanes. It was 13-6 at halftime, and Alabama, exercising opportunity, came up with interceptions that produced 14 points. Kevin Williams on the move will take it. still upright. He's still upright. I don't see any flags. Nobody has put a foot down to mark it. Touchdown, Miami.
Can you believe that? Unbelievable. I thought he was out of bounds over there.
I think a lot of people did. But William is, as we told you a while ago, you reach a hold of him, you think you got him, and all of a sudden you're looking at his pockets going away from him.
Well, to get back in this game, the Hurricanes needed some big plays, and we mentioned they do have some big play guys. This is 78 yards. This is a Sugar Bowl record. Williams is stopped. Sometimes when that happens, the defense, if the coverage team stops, he does stay in bounds.
Now there's nobody to really pursue him. And he canters into the end zone.
That's his
27-12.
First punt return for a touchdown this year. Last year he had three, but really has not shown a lot this year.
You know, that sort of reminds me of that UCLA-Nebraska game a few years ago. Remember that?
Yep.
Fella rolled over the top of somebody else, got up and walked 40 yards for a touchdown. Threw it for the point. Good. So 12:08 to go now. 27-13 ball game. Well, the yellow numbers tell you Miami will kick off. It's the first Sugar Bowl touchdown off a punt return in 21 years. Last man to do it was Tim Wiley of the Oklahoma Sooners. David Burnson fetching that out of the history book. And Alabama smells onside here. They've got DBs and receivers up.
It's Kevin Williams up there on the kickoff team, too, Keith.
Yep.
He's the safety. Safety valve.
Kick it away. Palmer circles at the five. It's all the way to the 40. I tell you, these two little guys are really something when they get that football and start looking for a hole.
Right side of your screen on the bottom there is Sonny Lubick. He is the defensive coordinator for the Hurricanes, has been for the last 4 years, and Sonny is moving on to be the head coach of the Colorado State.
Well, he was out there as an assistant.
Yes, he was.
Going
yes,
back.
He was.
Likes that lifestyle.
Yep.
Tommy Tuberville is going to move up and replace him as the defensive coordinator.
Uh-huh.
I have to talk to Tommy about that big loop and slice he hit across two fairways. Here comes Palmer around the corner, and Michael Barrow is waiting for him and puts him on the ground. In fact, there were two Canes staying at home, Dexter Siegler, the boundary cornerback, as well as Barrow.
Michael Barrow is playing in his 36th straight start. He is playing in his last game also as a Hurricane. He's their leading tackler and is their inspirational leader. Well, it was his 11th tackle on the night.
It's second down and 14. If they hold him right here, Bob, get a break right here and get another quick touchdown, it'll quicken the pulse a bit, won't it?
Just can't have a turnover. Fake reverse.
Lassick kept it. Picks his way through the crowd. Big play to midfield. Close to a first down.
Actually, if you're Alabama now, Keith, you don't need more points. What you'd really like to do is a drive, maybe 10, 12, 15 plays, and take some time off the clock. And if you do get some points at the end of it, that'd be great.
Okay, that may be a very big play right here, because if on second down and 14, you got him off the hook, got him into a position where they know at least it's third and one. And now they can take at least four more snaps. Boy, that's a big play.
It's a lot of time off the clock.
While they bring the chains in, we'll tell you it's a crowd of 76,789. Just a little short. Mm-hmm.
going to fake this reverse. They're going to fake it to Palmer. Palmer is a marked man. Whenever defenses come in, you see Crine, 91, was influenced by that. I'll tell you what, Lassick and Palmer, the two guys, the two main cogs in this Alabama offense, are really something.
It's about 6 inches that they need here on third down. Oh, look at this.
He got it.
Parker trying to sneak it. He just bounced off the first try. Armstead was the guy in the bottom.
Mm-hmm. Lopez was in there too, number 71 for the Hurricanes. But, you know, how do you, one of the linesmen on the side puts his foot down somewhere, and there's no way to get an accurate read, but this is just all part of the game.
Short. He needed 6 inches. He got three. He's Gene Stallings says go for it.
Got to think of Bear Bryant right here. You know, he talks so much like Bear Bryant. This offense, this whole team is very similar, what Bryant would have, Keith. And you knew him a lot better than anybody else probably, or more like most people. Strong defense and a strong running game.
Oh, he got it, but not by a whole bunch. Martin Houston, the bulk of the big fullback, is good for the first down.
Right side, that's Johnson, number 5, the tight end. Smith, 45, gets a piece of him, and then Barrow just falls off.
I'll tell you what Paul Bryant liked. He liked tweeners.
Uh-huh. You mean
guys that were not all Americans, yeah, out of high school, yeah, but guys who could play and guys that were coachable and people that would spend what they had and give him what they could afford. And
well, here's one right here in Jay Barker.
Yes, sir.
He is a hard worker.
A lot of them out there.
Yep.
This is Lassick. Well, I'm not so sure that Lassick, he had pretty good numbers coming out of Haverstraw, New York, but he was not a world beater. Otherwise, he'd never been able to get south. Somebody would have roped him in, but he shows up and he's had a terrific senior year.
Barrow fighting off the block of Shields, the center, gets a part of it, as does Greer.
Time remaining in the ball game, 9 minutes and 40 seconds, 27 to 13. 14-point deficit. Miami needs to get the ball back and then do something with it. Sherman Williams is the deep man. They show blitz. Marley does from the outside, takes off. Oh, he got a lick on him, too. And Houston will move the ball to about the 48. You can see Marley almost jumped. He got backed out of that neutral zone and then went after him and got him before he got to the line of scrimmage. Now Palmer and Brown will check into the lineup for Alabama.
It's one versus two.
Yep.
Number two has won the last four games.
Lynch is the big man. They pitch it back, however. Oh, look at this. Williams lets it go, and he throws. Oh, that's interference. They ran over Palmer. Three Canes down there, and they just ran over him. And it's a 15-yard penalty and a first down. Siegler and Greer and Harris, and I think all three of them got a piece of him. Little bit of resignation, yeah, there on the face of Dennis Erickson.
Well, he didn't have to interfere because the other man coming from the 29 is going to interfere with him, Greer. He doesn't see it, but from the left side right there, Harris would have intercepted the ball. The ball was underthrown. Now watch Palmer, number two, as he's going to have to slow up, come back. He's the only one that sees it. Yeah, he gets mugged by Greer.
That was a pathetic pass of Williams. He just slipped out of his hands. He didn't. He just lost his grip on it and couldn't spin it at all. But when they're going right, nobody ever asked how, did they? Just how many? First down from the 33 and up to Williams in the middle. Works his way down close to the 25. So they're doing here, I think, Bob, just what you mentioned a while ago. What they want to do is hold on to the ball.
Yep.
Snap the ball and run the clock. Pretty quiet over there on the side where the white shirts are resting.
Alabama's rushed for 234 yards. That's an average of 4.5 per carry. Those yardage is more than Miami has given up all year.
Timeout. 7:58 to play in the ball game. 14-point lead, Alabama. Well, it's a night for Roll Tide, and those of you in New Orleans who think you won't be hearing it into the wee hours of the morning, you better be getting on the train and going somewhere else, because these folks are going to have a party. 29 consecutive wins coming in here, so the last time they lost a game was October 20, 1990 at Notre Dame. And so some of these young people from Miami don't know the shock of losing a ball game. Williams carries there and rolls out of bounds to kill the clock. So they'll be looking at short coming up here.
Talk about the players at Miami. What about the coach? The coach has only lost three games in the 4 years that he's been at the university. Erickson is 44-3. Coming into the game tonight, he's won two titles in 3 years. Gene Stallings, on the other hand, only has lost six games in his 3 years. He's 30-6.
Yeah, but both of them have been seasoned.
Oh, yes.
Third and short. Third and about a yard and up the middle. So Houston keeps on pounding and gets the first down at about the 20-yard line. Well, you went through it with the Miami Dolphins. You guys won that championship 17-0. It must have been a shock even at an advanced.
It is. You just can't believe you're ever going to lose, Keith. And the Hurricanes this year pulled some games out that were very close, but eventually you have to lose. And the next year we came back and went 15-2 and were probably stronger than we were the year before and won another championship. So Miami's going to lose a lot of players, as I mentioned. They've got 13 fifth-year seniors on that ball club, but they've got a lot of young players to step up.
First down, Alabama, down at the Miami 20, leading 27-13 and 7:20 to play in the ball game. And up the middle goes Lynch. Inside the five, first and goal tied. And they're starting to dance in Opp and East Topoga and Coleman and Montgomery.
Just poor tackling and good running, good blocking by Alabama. Houston doesn't get a chance to carry the ball much. Six is Harris, the free safety. He misses. And Alabama has had it their way. Lynch, excuse me.
He's only a sophomore. He's got some time left to grow. Ball just inside the five, first and goal. And time call by Rogers Redding, charge to Alabama. There's some originality in that one, isn't there? But what these Hurricanes have done over the last decade is, it's one of the great stories in the history of sport. I don't care what your sport is. They're taking a licking tonight, but.
Well, they've been in the top three of the final AP polls seven straight years.
Yep. This is Williams. And Bass grabs a hold of it, rides him out of bounds at about the line of scrimmage. Michigan won today in the Rose Bowl, hitting by Washington. Terrific game. The Wolverines have now won 730 games, more than anybody else. Notre Dame has 7-11. And if Alabama holds on and wins here tonight, then Alabama and Texas will be tied for third with 682 wins. So That tells you something about what's been going on at Tuscaloosa all through this century. Second down, give it to Lassick. Turns the corner, touchdown.
Lassick scores the touchdown, but it's Hammond and Wilson and Johnson and Magnum up front. The guys doing the blocking. And Lynch, 45, the fullback. And is there any doubt who the national champion is?
Not in my mind. Lassick, 28 carries, 135 yards, 2 touchdowns. Point by Proctor. Good. At 6:46 to play in the game, I think I heard the door slam. 34-13, Alabama leads again by 21 points. One versus two in the Sugar Bowl, 79-83. Two beat one in both instances, and it's going to happen here for a third time. Those were not, as you would want to say, consensus. Those were AP polls. That's the one we've used this year. Carrying the ball is Chris Anderson. And Anderson's put down by Darren Smith. But Alabama's going to finish this season with 13 wins. That's the most ever in a single season for the university. They have won 10 or more football games 22 times in a single season. No other school has had that many 10-win seasons. They have won 20 Southeastern Conference championships. And it's kind of like that old-timer said when he called me the other day, that we weren't too bad back in the teens and 20s and 30s.
Uh-huh. Some people have said this year that Alabama had a soft schedule. And looking at it, five of their 12 opponents up until this game had only five of 12 had winning records. But as it went on, as it looked like we're getting something ready here for Coach Stallings. As it went on, they beat the best that the SEC had to offer.
And the SEC is undefeated in postseason play.
Yes, they are.
5-0 so far, and looked like they may be headed 6-0 if Mississippi State handles North Carolina. Bergdorf's an option man, and pretty quick comes out of Cedartown, Georgia. And he's pretty close to a first down with that play. Yes, they have mixed the brew now for the coach. I hope he wore an elderly coat. He won't care. He brought an extra. Clock moves inside of 3 minutes now, and
number 19 there is a freshman quarterback, if you're wondering.
Chad Keith. He better be pretty accurate. He might be.
You got that right.
Driving the equipment. He might be working for Tank next year.
He looked
year.
Awful young.
You can't help but feel sympathy for what's happened to the Miami team and Gino Toretta tonight. You have to, because they've had a very illustrious career.
Had a great run.
Just caved in on them.
Including the Heisman. There's Barker, who finishes up. He's 17 straight as a starter. He was 4 of 13 tonight for only 18 yards and had 2 intercepted. He rushed for 19 yards and passed for 18. So he actually ran for more yardage than he threw for.
Beal launched that one. Jonathan Harris let it go, and it's down at the 5-yard line by Alabama's Tommy Johnson. So when it's going right, sure does feel good. 2.5 minutes. And a lot of folks have started home already, I'm sure, just to begin the partying. But Donnell Bennett runs it well up the middle and gets a first down across the 20-yard line for Miami. I would imagine by the time.
Oh, that's cold there. They're putting ice in the water now. That's cold.
That's not too nice.
I mean, water is bad enough, but ice water.
There's Hootie now. Hootie's got a red coat on. That's liable to run.
Hootie better be smart and get away from the coach.
I noticed he's putting his glasses away. They smell something coming here. There's a quick shot to the sidelines. The pass is complete to Jonathan Harris for about six yards.
Toretta now is, if you're interested, 22 of 49 for 235 yards, but the key number is the three interceptions that were turned into three touchdowns for Alabama.
There was a building story for this Alabama defense as we neared the end of the season, Bob. In three of its last four games, Toretta back. Pass is no good. Incomplete. In three of the last four games, Alabama held LSU to 22 yards rushing. Auburn got 20 yards, and Florida got 30 yards on the ground. So the proof was in the pudding pretty good.
Oh, that's for sure. And they led the nation in run defense at Alabama defensively.
Miami has 22 today, including that last run by Bennett.
Well, you mentioned earlier, seven of the SEC's all-conference defensive players are on the defense, are on the Alabama defensive team.
This is Larry Jones, who has not played tonight, sophomore out of Gainesville. A big back for the Canes at 235 pounds. And so the young people going to have to step up now and be counted actually on both teams come next season. But it, for all intents and purposes, it looks like the national championship belongs to the Alabama Crimson Tide. Toretta lets it go. Lamar Thomas on the run, can't pull it down. Pass is incomplete. Executive producer of ABC Sports is Jack O'Hara. Coordinating producer of ABC's College Football, Bob Goodrich, who produced today's game. He was directed by Larry Cam. Good job, Larry. Technical director Gary Larkins, always good job, Gary. Associate producer for college football, Jim Ressler. Associate director David Kiviat. Production manager Arthur Budegian. Technical operations managers Mark Smith and Hal Schmitz. Assistants to the producer Steve Shunk and Paula Coker. Our statistician Dave Burnson. Our spotter Todd Barry. They run the ball with Bennett. No, not Bennett, Jones. And Jones, with fresh legs, moving it up near midfield. Our computer stats, Mark Amento. He's got to go to cold Minnesota tomorrow. And our booth coordinator, Paula DeBleek, who goes to cold Minnesota and calls it home. And our sideline coordinator, Dick Shepard.
Great job, guys and gals.
And Jack Arute is leaving shortly to join the party in East Tioga. Lamar Thomas was the target. Couldn't get it. In case you don't know, the Talladega racetrack's over there in East Tioga. And maybe, arguably, the best chicken fried steak in the world.
Been over there, huh?
Yes, I have. There's the disappointment on the face of the young men of Miami. Yeah, a little flip. Jones breaks some tackles. And they finally wrestle him down just over midfield. And we're coming up on a minute to play in the football game. And so in the USF&G Sugar Bowl, number two has turned away number one tonight. And the coach of number two is about to get soused. Just doused and drenched. That thing is full of water. And I think he knows it's coming. Oh, it's a shock. Toretta lets it go. Pass is caught. by Chris Jones down inside the 10, and Miami has a chance to put another touchdown on the board. But the frivolity has started on the Alabama side. The celebration has begun. I don't think that Alabama's going to really care a whole lot whether or not Miami puts it in the end zone here.
Well, Alabama's defense has not been scored on tonight. The one touchdown Miami did have, it was on a punt return.
Let's see, who did he put by? Did you put the big guys back in? No. Some are in there. Langham is in. I see Johnson in. Yeah, a lot of them are back in there. Copeland and Curry are not. This is Larry Jones. And he pounds his way down inside the 5. Valuable player has been named by the media. Miller Digby, most outstanding player ballot handed to me, says Derek Lassick of Alabama, who had 28 carries for 135 yards and 2 touchdowns. The time remaining in the ball game, 10 seconds. Pass is incomplete.
Well, there's no question that Lassick is deserving for what he has done, but I'll tell you what, there's some players on that Alabama defense that certainly needed some strong consideration. Tommy Johnson, George Teague.
Ruthie just can't.
She's
a nice lady.
She sure is. Yeah, you can finally raise that finger and say we're number one.
To the corner for Joe. Got it.
No, he's out of bounds.
Out of bounds.
Nice call.
Game's over. Alabama defeats Miami. Number 2 beats number 1, 34-13. And I'm going to say it for the second time, I do believe Beams Stallings has succeeded. But there. Jack Arute with a man who was very prominent in tonight's ball game, George Teague.
Well, George, first of all, even though it was called back for an offside, describe how you made that great steal from Thomas.
Oh, wow. It was very exciting. I thought he was going to score. I had to pick it up a little bit. I was fortunate enough to get my hand in, rip it out, and hold on to it and try to run.
And then the key play of the game, absolutely. Take us through the interception.
Oh, I've been dreaming of one of those about 4 years now. Gino, he just happened to throw it right to me. They had nobody in front of me. Went in for a score.
You know, all year you had to read in the polls, Miami number one, Miami number one. There was one guy in Arizona said that Alabama was number one. How sweet is this victory tonight?
I'll tell you what, it's so sweet. If I have 5 pounds of sugar, I can take it all in right now.
I think that says it all, Keith.
Well, they didn't stumble into it. They didn't back into it. They just whipped to Miami 34-13. Keith Jackson, Bob Greasy, Jack Arute, we hope you enjoyed it. We wish all of you a happy and prosperous and healthy New Year.